This is Sarah Drew. She is a jeweller, artist, and forager of found objects. She lives in Cornwall with her husband Tom and boys Joseph and Alfie, and loves spending time outdoors collecting and making things out of what she finds. She works from her dedicated studio space in St.Austell and takes regular trips to scour both the north and south coasts for washed up treasures. From her finds, she makes contemporary, eclectic, wearable pieces of art, which she combines with eco-silver, semi-precious stones and pearls. Her jewellery is inspired by the materials she finds, and from her extensive knowledge of cold connection techniques, she is able to wrap, crochet, thread, and create beautiful, bold statement pieces. Alongside her jewellery practice, she runs in-person workshops from both her studio in St.Austell, luxury hotels around Cornwall, and on occasion, Westdean College in Chichester. She teaches a wide range of techniques, including threading, wire wrapping, and crocheting. She has authored 3 books on jewellery making, and with her artist friend Suzanne, has just recently successfully run her first art and craft show called Narrative Fair. Today I chat with her about her fascination with found objects, her love of jewellery making, and how working and collaborating with others on large-scale art exhibitions helps to inform and keep her jewellery making fresh and enjoyable. I'm Mel Chadwick, this is Season 2, Episode 3. Welcome to Creative Conversations. Hi guys, welcome to another Creative Conversation. And today I am in the studio of Sarah Drew. Welcome, Sarah.
Hello.
Thank you for having me.
You're
in
welcome.
The studio.
Nice to see you.
Do you want to just talk about what it is that you do?
Yeah, so I make, I'd call it art jewellery really. That's the jewellery that I like making best of all. From found materials such as sea plastic, sea glass, driftwood, and ghost net, things that I collect off the beach, coupled with eco silver, brass, and sustainable stones.
Cool. And how long have you been doing that for?
Well, I set the business up in 2000, actually, so 19 years now,
wow.
Which seems like a very long time. I started off originally, though, doing a lot of bridal tiaras, using vintage brooches to make wedding jewellery and things like that, really, and bags, actually, and beaded jewellery. And it's just shifted, because I set that up when I was in York, and when I moved down to Cornwall, it's just shifted and turned into what I make now, really.
When did you move down to Cornwall?
Moved down in 2003, just when my first lad, Joseph, was a year old. And, yeah, it was lovely. I mean, you know, we just wanted to live by the sea.
Yeah.
It was completely daft. Idea really, but then it's panned out beautifully. And you know, we having kids and toddlers and dogs, we were at the beach every day, and so I was collecting stuff.
Have you always been in this area, like St.Austell?
Yeah, I have actually, because Tom, my husband, got a job in Truro, and it was affordable to buy somewhere in St.Austell, and it was a bit near the sea. We wanted to be able to, because I couldn't drive at that point, so I could walk to the beach.
So
it does feel like home here now.
Yeah. And at the moment, we're in your studio space, which is actually in a college.
Yeah.
Do you want to just tell us a bit about what areas you've got in this space?
Yeah, I mean, it was such a treat to move in here. I've been here about 18 months now, and before that, I'd been working in a tiny little space, like my work table space, really, in the shed, in the end of our shed at home. With a leaky roof that used to drip down the back of my neck making jewellery, so I was thoroughly fed up, to be honest with you. Bikes behind me. And Suzanne, my friend who's got a studio next to me, she works at the college, and she said these spaces were coming up, so we moved in last September. And yeah, it's a massive space, so I can teach workshops here. I've got a table in the middle to teach workshops. I've got my workspace where with a sea view, so I can look outside and while I'm working, somewhere to sit down, have a snooze. And yeah, it's just a really nice. I have to have a few projects on the go at the same time. I've got space to spread out a bit.
And you don't have to put anything away, I guess.
It does make a massive difference. Yes, it's a case of... And I think a lot of people work like that, don't they, where you have a few things going on and you can work on a certain process and then move along to something else, and it's sort of quite a productive way of doing things, really.
Definitely. So how do you run your business, and what kind of different things do you do, like workshops?
Yes, so the workshops are quite nice to tick over, and that means I've got a steady income, so that, you know, I'm not... sometimes it must be the same for a lot of makers, but I do mostly wholesale, and sometimes I have busy peers and others.
Yeah.
So it's quite nice to have the workshops going on so that I know I've got a certain amount of money to cover my rent every month.
Yeah.
So I probably do probably about 4 months here. And then I do mostly wholesale now, so I take orders from shops and galleries and make stuff up for them and send it out and they sell it for me.
Oh, brilliant. That's really cool.
Yeah.
I mean, how do you, though, go about building those relationships?
Well, to be honest, when I first moved down here, I did it the old school way of going into galleries and saying, hello, I'm Duke, you know, would you like to see my work? And to be honest with you, they were lovely. Most of my, you know, original customers like that were really friendly and really receptive and said, yep, we'll give it a go, we'll try it, see how it goes. So it was literally like making friends, really, just face to face, going in and seeing them. But obviously in that time, technology's rocketed, hasn't it? And so I think quite a lot gets done on Instagram and, you know, people getting a sort of feel for your work and your business. And so I've had people contact me through my website and Instagram now. And Top Draw, you know, going to, that made a massive difference to business.
So let's, talk about Top Draw. Top Draw is it something that happens twice a year?
It is. I only go to the January one, though. It's not really expensive, but it's quite expensive for a small business to go twice a year. And I think the January one suits me because that's to stock the shops with summer products and that. My stuff seems to go better in summer.
So it's not like a craft fair, it's actually for
trade, for the shops and galleries. Yeah. So they come along, it's massive, it's in Olympia in London, and basically they have different sections, like home sections, jewellery section, fashion, but I was in the craft section, so I think the people that come into the craft section were wanting to buy unique pieces, and so they came along expecting things to be a bit different.
Yeah.
So it worked really well.
I can imagine they've found that in your work.
Yeah, and I was really pleased because I took along my big collage necklaces, which I love making, but they've not necessarily been the most commercial pieces that I make.
Yeah.
And I took them along and put them on the wall thinking, oh, well, there'll be a talking point. And they all sold.
Wow.
Yeah, some of them several times over. I had to make similar ones. And, yes, I went up to Scotland. This time I had a couple go to Paris, so, you know.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I was really pleased that the things that I like making best of all were received really well.
Is that what you're wearing now?
Yeah. So it's just really fun, and I do like big jewellery myself, so, it's quite nice to have the scope of using found materials because you can make things on large scale.
So that's what... Yeah, let's talk about that. Let's talk about what kind of materials do you use in your jewellery?
Basically, the materials almost decide the design, really.
Yeah.
So I go out the North Coast beaches, my new key. I tend to find a lot of the sea plastic and the ghost net. So I collect that and just keep it and wait till... You know, I'm ready to make something from it.
Yeah.
This south coast, I get sea glass and driftwood from Pentium beaches, local to me. So I lay things out and basically get a design and then think about ways to connect them. And it's quite interesting because you can't heat up things like wood and plastic. You have to have cold connections, so you have to think about threading and crocheting and things like that, that you can put things together without having to heat them up.
Wow. So you need actually quite a few different skills when you're making up the jewellery.
Yeah.
It's not just a simple, you know, I do this and that's it.
No, I think it's sort of because I'm self-taught and I've come at things from slightly different angles and from a bit of a textile background, I think it's that problem-solving thing that comes with just trying to work things out yourself, really, and through YouTube. And so it's sort of, my jewellery's come about by what I like doing in a way, really.
Wow. How does that work, though, for people putting in big orders? Because obviously, like, you can't reproduce every necklace.
I take lots of photos. And this technology, again, has been really useful now. So basically, I lay them all out, a bit like a flat lay, really, and say, this is what I'm thinking about making, which ones do you like? And they go, well, I like that, but I don't want that C-string then. So we kind of work out the design a bit
together.
So
it's like a collaboration. And I guess also you could do colour palettes or something.
Yeah.
People want this colour.
So they say, like, turquoise is always popular. Yeah. So they say, can you do blue turquoise if you want? And at the last show, I didn't expect it to be really popular, but I made this one that was, like, quite teal and driftwood. And I sold that 3 times. So I've had to send photos and say, this is similar, is this okay?
Yeah.
So then they know that they kind of don't want exactly like, you know, similar to that. So then I can get around that, really.
That's so cool.
Mm. It is, and I think like I say, the people who come into the craft section there were wanting one-off pieces. So there's a shop in Scotland, Longstraw, where basically they get lots of people from the cruise ships. So they get Americans and they want to eat. And I think in Scotland they get a lot of debris on the beaches, don't they? So it's a similar sort of thing to what we have in Cornwall, where it's nice to clear the beach and do stuff with them. And then I've got things I can remake, which I sell on my website, which are things like the earrings. So I use like recycled silver and brass. And so those are things that they can say. Yeah. It's going to be almost exactly like this ring.
Do you get also kind of bespoke commissions, you know, for like weddings or...
Not so much weddings now. I've stopped doing the weddings, to be honest with you. I think that's shifted a bit. And I think because I quite like making really bright... it's a bit less bridal now. But I'm happy to do things for weddings, but it tends to be... You know, people might send me a piece of glass from the holiday and they want to make that up. Or it's got special associations.
Oh, that's a really nice idea, isn't it? So if you go on holiday and you find something, they should just get in touch with you and you'll make it into
your
jewellery.
And with kids as well. So, like, I made a pendant for Lady because her lad had given her this sort of love heart piece of slate. So she wanted... That's got that association, that link to your family. And I think that's quite nice to have that personal link with jewellery.
Yeah. So what kind of keeps you motivated?
I never have a problem with that. I really don't. I don't mean to be annoying about that, but because I love it. I completely love it. So it's not a case of I don't feel like there's never a time I'll come into work and think, oh, I don't feel like doing this today. I think it's always there's boring things that I make. That's a bit, yes. Yeah. There's times where I have to get the boring things out of the way and then I can make fun things.
What about the admin side of it?
Oh yeah, I'm rubbish at that. I'm really rubbish at that. Yeah, that gets left. But the baking's great and not problem with motivation. Yeah. The admin. I think from a point of view, I've got to, like, my lads are older now and I'm doing this full time and they've got more expensive. So I'm trying to earn a certain amount of money. So the admin, the motivation really is just I've got to get paid and I've just got to be sensible and try and be a bit more organised.
Yeah.
So that is just something I know that it's a process that if I want to actually to get the cash coming in, then I've got to do that.
And so does that go into your marketing kind of plan? Do you know what kind of marketing things you're going to focus on, you know, or posts that you're going to write? Or
not very conscious of how that happens, but I don't know how you are, but I think with social media it's quite a sociable way of doing things. I think a lot of women maybe do things in the natural way, don't they? And it's so I'm not very conscious about branding and this, that and the other, but I think it's just I actually do like putting photos on Instagram and sharing
your process.
Yeah, yeah. So it's a bit more like that. It's a bit more like of just me muddling through, really, and trying to... And I think because making things is quite a solitary job, it is quite nice to have those sort of actual proper contacts with people, you know, through social media. And I joined up with the Etsy Makers group.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that was quite nice to get out into a bit more of a social situation of working with other people. And, so I think the marketing really is kind of like... I think I'm quite good at marketing from the point of view of I like people, and I do like talking to people, and I think that's the main thing really, isn't it?
Just getting the message. That people actually kind of get a sense of who you are as well.
Yeah.
And that comes across in how you conduct your business.
Yeah. And it's remembering to state the obvious, isn't it? Because I think sometimes you sort of assume people know what you're doing.
Yeah.
But I have to remember that I have to explain things sometimes. And
That it isn't all... You know, self-explanatory.
No, I kind of think, oh, it's a given because I've been doing it for a while. But then you do have to say, well, this is why I'm doing it, and you know, I like that, and I like going to a show, and when people come and talk to you about what they collect or what they find or watching the Blue Planet, and you know, it's people are really receptive to wanting to know the bit of meaning behind it.
Yeah, and I guess actually, what you're doing is that you've got seeing an opportunity to actually, you know, reuse all these plastics that have washed up on the beach, and a lot of people just see it as a problem, but you're making something beautiful out of it.
I mean, if I'm honest, that's how it came about, because I went to the beach, I found these things, I liked the shapes, I liked the colours, and I started doing it like that, and then gradually, you know, when it became obvious that it was a problem for marine animals have been on the beaches and on the sea, then that's been like a nice a way of putting the two together, of being bothered about the natural environment.
Do you find people send you stuff?
Yes. I mean, like that. I'm really pleased, and it's quite nice because you get from different areas, and I don't know if you collect stuff, but you become aware that things weather in slightly different ways depending on where you found them, really. And different things get washed up on different beaches. And I did geography at school, so I'm quite interested in that whole where things have come from and travel and, you know, the tides and things like that. So
that would be cool, though, sending stuff to you.
I know, it is.
From
nice,
all over the world.
Nice. Yes. And I have had things. A lady just got in touch from Scotland, actually. She said she's doing the beach cleans up there and she'd like to do the plastic. I was like,
I'll do beach cleans down in Plurid. So
if
we find anything.
It's lovely. And I think as well, because I do the workshops, it's quite nice to have a lot for people to choose from.
Yeah.
And and people sort of go for different things appeal to them. There's bits that I know that I really like, but then, you know, if you're doing workshops, it's quite nice to have a selection, really.
Yeah, I like that.
Yeah, it's good fun.
What kind of projects are you working on at the moment?
Well, I'm still trying to get through my orders from top drawer, to be honest with you. I've got had 17 new shops.
Wow.
Yeah, so it was full on, really, which I was really pleased about. I'm not worried at all, but I've got to get all those done. And two of those were galleries that wanted to put on exhibitions, so that's really cool because I can make really crazy things. It's quite a scope to go a bit daft.
Yeah.
And they wanted quite sort of, you know, extravagantly different sort of stuff. So that's fun. Me and Susanna are organising a fair. We've got a craft and art fair at the college here in the Key Theatre, and that's been received so well. I'm really pleased because we've got some really good makers on board, and the college is really helping, and the students are up for it. So it's quite a nice way of connecting, like, the student population with local makers. Right?
Yeah. And what's that called? The fair?
Narrative.
So did you always think about wanting to put on a fair, or is that something that just came about?
I think it's, to be honest with you, there's I don't sound negative saying this, but there's some fairs that I've done where I've gone elsewhere in the country and they've been really hard work and it's been really, you know, a real slog. And I think because me and Susanna are here and we know it's a really nice, with the view and everything, the lawns, it's a really nice place to put something on. It's quite nice to sort of have something local that's affordable. And I do think this area of St.Austell is a bit under... represented, really.
Yeah,
so I think it's quite nice to say, look, this is what people are doing here, and it's sort of making that visible. And also the students, I think it's, you know, I'm not really in a position at the moment to offer an apprenticeship, but it's quite nice to be able to encourage the students and say, this is how you sell your stuff, really, and you know, help each other, really, in that sense, and say that you can have a creative career in Cornwall.
That's really important, though, I think. So a lot of people think they've got to leave Cornwall sometimes to have a creative career.
I mean, for me, it's been much better. Because
you've moved here, haven't you?
Yeah, so. And it was harder up there, and I think it's harder in London because it's harder to get to see the people who can sell from you, and the shows are much more expensive. And I think people are really receptive to handmade and artistic things in Cornwall, and so they actually buy them.
Mm.
Normal people do, as well as tourists. So I think you've got a lot more, you know, potential customers, haven't you?
Yeah. Okay, what kind of advice would you give to someone younger starting out? What kind of plans do you have for the future?
So basically, I'm really enjoying doing the big jewellery, and I'm trying to think more, like, do more artistic pieces, so some big sculptures that'll tie in with my collage necklaces. So I've got an exhibition planned for this summer in August in Circa 21 in Penzance with my sister-in-law, so we're going to do, like, a bit more of a proper art exhibition, really. And also next year, there's an artist, Cameron McKendoo, who's got a studio here, so we're planning an exhibition, probably in rock, actually. And it's nice to do things on that scale because it sort of keeps me thinking artistically, and then it can inform my jewellery and basically make my jewellery fresh and keep that fun, really.
It's a bit like fashion... You know, fashion shows, you know, how it filters down to the high street.
Yeah, and I do think it's keeping the enjoyment then. And anybody who's self-employed and a maker will, you know, it's not necessarily an easy job. I love it, but if you're not enjoying it, there's no point doing it, really. So it's kind of keeping the enjoyment there and then, you know, making sure that, it's not getting boring, really.
Yeah. Mm. And collaborating, I think, with other people is really key.
I think it's something I underestimated for a while, and you know, I think I got a little bit introverted, and I think it's quite nice to get out of your workspace and remember how to work in a team.
Yeah.
And you'd have to do everything yourself, and it takes the responsibility off your shoulders a bit, and it is quite nice to share that and bounce ideas off each other. It probably improves what you're doing.
What advice would you give to your younger self?
I think it's quite interesting thing about that, isn't it? Because I think I did things in a real roundabout, daft way, really, to be honest with you. And I think I'd say to my younger self, or somebody young now, just get on with it. Just get on with it. Just be honest with yourself. Think, you know, be honest with yourself about what you want to do. You've got nothing to lose, especially if you haven't got an expensive mortgage and you haven't got kids. You may as well give it a go while you're young. And don't worry too much about what other people think. I think it's really, and it helps if you've got people, you know, supporting you, say, and encouraging you about your work and everything. But, you know, don't worry too much about what they think of things, and just get on with it. And if somebody says no to you, go, all right, fair enough, you don't like it, I'll go on to somebody else.
Yeah.
And don't take that criticism too much to heart and let put you off, really. Mm-hmm.
thanks so much, Sarah, for talking to us today. And I hope, guys, that you found this really interesting. Again, please go and check out Sarah's website and her Instagram. All the links will be below. And if you have any comments or questions, just pop them in the comment section as well. See you again, guys, for another creative conversation very soon. Bye.
Bye.
I will see you again for another creative conversation very soon. Have a good day.
Bye.
Did I say have a good day?
Yeah, so I'd clean that up now, and I'll probably just connect that to some more of that chain at the top, really.
Liquid and fill the gap in.
Oh yeah,
then it's stuck.
It.
Yeah.
I really like it. I really like doing it. I really like making chain. You know, when I do the workshops, it's not a popular workshop actually, the chain making one. I'm not really sure why, because it's one of my favourite things to do, and it sort of adds up quickly.
Yeah.
So you have quite quick results. You're not sort of here forever doing something really fiddly there. Just trying not to burn that setting on there. That's why I'm taking a bit long on this one.
This was Creative Conversations, and I'm Mel Chadwick.